Okay, that was a test. Good morning.
Praise the Lord.
Sit down. Order. Yeah, we need a gavel. All right. Can I hear an amen? I want to make sure that you're paying attention. All right. Can you hear me? Can you hear me well? No? I'll try to project. Is that better? All right. Bringing back the old jokes. Live from Des Moines, abundant life, right? All right. Well, these are exciting times. You know, good things are happening in our lives and all those things. As most of you know, I started a backyard chicken farm hobby with my lovely wife. So I'm trying to mentally prepare myself for next weekend because it's going to come full circle. I'm going to harvest my first bird. So never done that before, but that rooster got to go. Anyway, I'll be brief. This is what I want to share with you today is something that the Lord put in my heart earlier this week. And I don't know, I just thought it was very nice of him to remind me of these things. So I was at work, on my way to work, I believe it was Tuesday. I was talking to my mother, like I try to do every morning before getting to work. And she asked me to pray for one of her friends. They found a lump in one of her breasts, and they did a biopsy, and it came out positive for cancer. So she's like very distraught and all those things. So when I got to work, I was sitting on my desk, and I was working, and I was thinking, the Lord reminded me of that petition that my mom had made, but he also put on my heart to pray for another person. So instead of questioning, what do you want me to pray for, I just started declaring things.
There you go.
For both individuals. And the thing that stood out the most from all these things that I was experiencing was this phrase, "It is well." And I started thinking about the hymnal, I believe it is a hymnal,
yep.
Which I didn't know was written in the 1800s.
Mm-hmm.
So I started looking up some scriptures and all that, and I want to start with this, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. So we go through a lot of things in our life. And one thing that I love about our journey as Christians is that before we accepted Jesus as our Savior, we were a mess. But once the transition began and we started growing and digging more into the Word, and continue to be renewed, we start to notice that our past, even though it was chaotic, it doesn't seem so bad because we start to see how God has always been with us. So that takes me to Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And then Psalm 118, it says from verses 6 to 9, the Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side as my helper. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. So I started meditating on this, and it took me back, excuse me, to the story of the Shunammite woman in 2 Kings. And this is a very powerful scripture, because you know that the miracle that she was given of a child, it ended in this world because he died. But she went back to Elisha. And then it says in verses 25 and 26, so she went and came unto the man of God to Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her afar off, that he said to Gehazi, excuse me, his servant, behold, yonder is that Shunammite. And then he told his servant to ask her three questions. He says, run now, I pray thee, to meet her, and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with the child? And the way she responded to those questions is what framed her miracle to come back. And she said, it is well. That's what we need to do when we're facing difficult situations.
Yes.
Because our journey as Christians did not start yesterday or 5 minutes ago.
Right.
We've been at this for a while.
Right.
So all we have to do is look back at all the things that God has done for us.
Yep.
And realize that in those difficult times, everything changed because it is well.
Yes.
So this verse from the song, it says, though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ had regarded my helpless estate and had shed his own blood for my soul. All over the Bible, we are reminded about the goodness of God, about who Jesus Christ is, why he came, and what he did for us. And all those things, the more we study them, the more we read them, the more we embed them in our heart, will continue to reaffirm that it is well.
Yes.
And I want to read this last scripture that I believe explains all of this very well. And it's from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And I'm going to read verses 8 through 18. It says, we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken.
Mm-hmm.
Struck down, but not destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith according to what has been written, I believe and so I spoke. We also believe and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence.
Yes.
For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away. Our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. So all you have to do is believe and speak. So you believe and you say, it is well. Any prayer requests or testimonies? Anecdotes? Yes, James.
I have a prayer request. This is unusual. I have an older dog and he's got some back issues, and I wanted to ask my opinion. Is it we're going to try to? quite as old as the other one, but I just have trouble walking up steps, and I'm hoping that I can do, you know, a little fish oil type of stuff and try to get him to do a little bit better. And hopefully we won't have any anxiety. He's getting along good in the cat, but it's just I'm concerned taking care of this now rather than waiting like me and in recent couple of years and I haven't got that bad. I got really sick. So we went got two propellers. And another thing I'm really happy for, I don't know if you guys know this, that Northwest the state for the first time in so many years, and I grew up in that high school with the back in the day where we wouldn't win, well, let's say we could win for losing, but the first time I've ever seen that happen was in the 91, and I witnessed it. So again, I'm probably not going to be there Wednesday just to cheer North on for our side because I think we well deserve it. And we get to stand up for our principles, and you know, maybe we can proclaim Jesus through the schools and through our county and everywhere we compete. So I feel that I must be, you know, be happy for them and show some grace and some gratitude. And, you'll miss me Wednesday, but to be down there to where I grew up, it's like probably a big memory. It's probably the biggest memory of my life. So, God bless you guys.
All right.
I appreciate worshiping with you all the years.
Amen.
Thank you, God.
Yes, sir.
We travel the next 2 weeks for spring break. We're headed south to see my brother. And just ask for prayer for protection upon us and that we still shine the light of grace to them. I feel God is revealing to them the grace message, but it's still mixed. They still point a lot back to you have. So, and with the death of the pastor and his wife's son, emotions are high, and we run into a couple instances with them since December. And I just pray, you know, that we've prayed, where else should we go for spring break? It's always back there. So I know God's got a good plan. Tammy just confirmed that by sharing a word with me. And I just want them to be set free. I just want them to be set free to worship God in a way that we have felt here. And again, they're for Jesus. So, you know, it's like, but I just, the message, what I'm reading, can't be mixed. It can't be mixed. It's got to be one or the other. And that's where I feel like Toby and I can really shine that light to them. So
amen.
Just pray for that.
Amen.
To kind of go along with what you were saying about speaking in it as well, I won't go get the book and read the page, but it's from the book that has the daily things with the teacher and the student. And they were walking. They were walking on a path during the day. And as they walked along this path, the teacher would ask him, what would you name this road? And he said, at that point, it was the Rocky Road. And then they walked a little longer, and he said, and what would you name the road now? And he said, I would call it the Curvy Road. And he said, and then they walked a little further, and he said, and what would you name this road? And he said, I would call it the Sandy Road. And it continued several different examples or whatever. But then the teacher said, the roads back in the Bible, the road to Emmaus, the road to Damascus. They were roads to a destination. You spoke of the destination. You didn't speak of the circumstances around you. So no matter what it looks like around you, we should be speaking to what we see, to what's ahead, where we're headed.
Thank you, God.
And to go with that then and have this scripture, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before.
Yes.
I pray keep our focus ahead and on Him and speak where we're going and not about what's around us.
Yes, 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 yes.
To add a little to what you said about freedom, when I started my journey as a Christian, there were two things that really helped me understand what is my role in all of this, in my relationship between God and me. And one was, I was reading this book that is called No Excuses, The Power of Self-Discipline. And there's a chapter that talks about responsibility. And there was a section in there that says that until you accept responsibility for every decision that you have made in your life and stop blaming others, you will continue to be an emotional child. So after I read that, I just stopped and I looked straight ahead and I said, I take responsibility for every decision that I have made that has led me to where I am right now. Mm-hmm. And I felt like the weight of the world was lifted off my shoulders.
Amen.
From that moment on, I stopped blaming others for things that were happening to me or circumstances or whatever. The other moment was a moment in which God revealed to me that it is okay for me to ask for things for myself. Because when I started as a Christian and I prayed, I never prayed for anything for me because I didn't feel that I deserved it. And it was very, that moment when I heard you can ask things for yourself because you're worth it.
Yeah. Amen.
Everything changed.
Yes.
So, it'll happen.
Yeah.
Mike, sorry.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, a couple of things. There's my granddaughter and other people going on trips also on spring break. And, pray for protection of all the traveling and stuff. Second of all, the paths and the streets and the dreams have come upon some of the youth here, 12 years and older. Christ in Action, CAA for short.
this of all the others that wanted to bring stuff, I appreciate. Only a couple months out, they told me, you know, 3-4 months. I don't feel that's true at all. Because we got a big guy, Alvin. I see the surgeon tomorrow, and I'm not supposed to be walking. But, you know, I don't hurt. I have no pain at all. So I know it's healing on the inside as well as the outside. So I thank the Lord for that. As she was talking, I have a friend who called me last night, and we're praying for this little 10-year-old boy. The doctors cannot find what's going on with him. He has massive headaches all day long, and they don't know what's going on. Been to multiple doctors. So she says, does your church, she knows we believe in healing. I gave her what Don had said and what Mike had said, you know, that we see people just being healed all the time, and that the Lord's got, you know, more healings in store. That Mike said probably a couple blocks down people would be waiting. So, you know, I encouraged her to bring him, but I encouraged her to tell this lady to read scripture. She says, well, if we come, would your preacher preach a couple sermons on healing? I'm like, what do you need to know? I mean, the Lord is our healer. What more do we need to know than that, you know? But just the understanding, like she was saying, that you talk to people that's been for years, and you're like, dude, what part of this are you not understanding? But in any case, we just have to be patient and just continue to be patient and try to expound to them the word more clearly, as the Bible says, right? But and in the meantime, let's just really pray for this. This lady wants to come to our seminar, bring this lady. I said, well, bring the 10-year-old. You know, we'll anoint him with prayer while he's here. I don't care if it's a bunch of women. Doesn't matter. You know, the Lord's no respecter of anything. So, but I expect to hear, you know, there's no reason. We can pray, and this little boy can, headaches be gone today. There's no reason he has to wait a month, 2 months for a healing service or whatever she's asking for, you know.
Right.
So I don't know his name. I just know he's a 10-year-old little boy that needs a healing.
Thank you, God.
Amen.
Thank you, God.
Anyone else?
Thank you, Lord.
All right, let's stand. And let's come to the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you for bringing us here to be gathered in your name. We thank you, Father, because through your grace we have been saved. We know, Father, that you have showed us that you love us unconditionally, Lord, and you give us all things according to your will and purpose, to your grace. We thank you, Father, for all the petitions that have been brought forth today. We pray, Father, for healing and their family. Be saved and protected. On their trip as they travel south to spring break. We ask, Father, that you continue to shine your light through them, and they continue to be a vessel of your warmth and grace, Lord, to spread your word to those that are in need of hearing your word. We pray, Father, to continue to enjoy this time in your heart. We declare right now in your name, Jesus, that the healing is taking place and those headaches are gone. Right now, and we praise you and thank you because we know that you have declared it so. We also pray, Father, for Tim's prayer, Lord. We ask, Father, that the healing is manifested in him, and all the health issues that he is having, Lord, are gone in Jesus' name. We also pray for her, that you continue to give her guidance, wisdom, and revelation. Reveal to her the path that you have laid upon her for her to follow. That you continue to be glorified and magnified, Lord. And she continues to be blessed as those things are happening in that
presence.
We thank you, Father, because you have called us to serve with purpose. And you continue to reveal to us through your Holy Spirit what that purpose is that we continue to follow. We know, Lord, that even though we face difficult circumstances every day, that it is well, everything is well with our souls. We know, Father, that you are always with us, holding us, guiding us, protecting us, Lord, so that you continue to be glorified and magnified in your purposes, Lord, for our lives and for those that are seeking you and that you will fulfill. Lord, thank you, Father, for bringing this body, for all the prayers that we elevate, all the doubt that we cast upon you, Father, that you take care of all of those that you have said that you will. We thank you for listening to our prayers and for answering them, and for giving us the patience as we continue to wait for the manifestation of your glory. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us. sacrifice and died for us so that we can be saved and bring us on to God. We thank you, Father, for giving us the revelation through your Holy Spirit so that we can continue to understand what our purpose is in this life. We see to understand your word and your message that you have given us as to who you are and how much you love us. Pray, Father, as we continue to go forward and the things that are happening and manifesting, that you continue to shine your light in this place, that you continue to reveal to others the message that you want to convey. We thank you, Father, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Cell phone, please turn it off or silence it. Thank you. Okay, so this Friday, March 10th, we're going to have our Eastern Gate House of Prayer. It is the first step into a series of events that will take place through the entire weekend. Mike, what are we going to do? Just press on?
Press on. We don't need to press in because we're already there, the pastor mentioned. Why do we need to press in somewhere that's already here? Okay, we need to understand what we have pressed into. Okay, we just need to learn how to understand how to release the kingdom of God that is with us when we receive Christ. We need to learn. Okay, it's ready to explode. People have in their lives through their own mindset have pulled the fuse out of the bombs that wants to explode in their lives. And speaking visually, because that's just the way I am, I'm seeing fuses being restored. I'm seeing foreign fuses put back in. I guess the only Latin I can really think of is the word dunamis. Not as Greek, isn't it? Yeah, dunamis, which is where we get the word dynamite. And there's a lot of dynamite in here. I see a lot of sticks of dynamite. And all I can say is fire up. And don't wait. Don't wait.
Okay, and then the next day, Saturday, there will be a 12-hour prayer of Bernard Ankeny at Harmon Church. We have been invited to participate, and we will be doing a worship set from 5 to 7.
5 to 7.
If you can come, please do so. Great things happen. If you can come to the House of Prayer on Friday, do so as well. A lot of things are happening. Songs are being revealed and being birthed in this place. Words are being released.
Yes.
And it's not only here, it's in different areas of the state as well. Mike is being contacted by all these different people. Hey, this is happening and all those things. And the hunger that we have in here is starting to pop up in other places. We need to come together.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, let's speak the word this morning.
We do not abide in sin, that your people may rejoice in you.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law.
Therefore,
Thank you, Jesus. Let's celebrate the Lord right now. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we love you. We praise you. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing and what you've already done in this service, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Lord, you are great and mighty. There's none like you, Lord. You alone are God. We celebrate you this morning in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated. Thank you, Roberto, for opening and sharing. Thank you, everybody that had a testimony, and thank you for sharing your prayer requests. Praise the Lord. And your victories. Praise God. God is good. Amen. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Mike, and worship team, as always, great job helping us to enter into his presence. Amen. We know that he's ever present, but our awareness of that sometimes comes and goes. Praise the Lord. It's good to be reminded, amen, that he inhabits the praises of his people. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. All right. I will just mention one thing in passing for the next few weeks. When you come through those front doors, be aware there will be box elder bugs. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Every year this time. I don't know why. If it's not them, it's those little beetle things, the little whatever they are. Praise the Lord. Those little bugs. Praise God. But I don't know why. I know why, because, you know, the sun is on that side of the building, and so they gather there for the heat, you know. But they are a nuisance and a pain, so just recognize that. You may bring in a guest, praise the Lord. So, all right, I want to get right to the word this morning, amen. And if we would, let's begin with Jeremiah chapter 16, and we'll read verses 19 through 21. So it's Jeremiah 16. Verses 19 through 21, and I do have a lot of scriptures today, so look out, Mike. Praise the Lord. He can do it. I know that. Praise God. Amen. Great weather. I'm a little overcast today, but the temperature is outstanding. Praise the Lord. It's Jeremiah chapter 16, verses 19 through 21.
The service one night I had both her and Tracy there, and when you sing these old songs, Mike, especially, I mean, that one with the three parts we used to sing every trip, and they just kind of sat on my couch and they just kind of cry. So I'm videotaping, not just for this, I'm videotaping because that's the way I can minister to my kids.
Sure.
They're getting really put right back into them.
Amen.
Especially the oldies. So thank you, Mike,
Lord,
for doing some oldies today, because
amen,
you know, they love watching her, but I mean, the presence of the Lord falls in my place on my couch while they're watching this baby.
Thank the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. O Lord, my strength and my fortress, my refuge in the day of affliction, the Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth, and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies, vanity, and things wherein there is no profit. Shall a man make gods unto himself, and they are no gods? Therefore, behold, I will this once cause them to know. I will cause them to know my hand and my might, and they shall know that my name is the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I may seem to be just scattered this morning, and I hope that I'm not. I hope I can, you know, make sense and some continuity out of this. But, you know, I read that scripture, and I know what it's talking about, but I know so there are also multiple inferences in the scripture that God tries to get our attention. And in one sense, I would say that scripture speaks to the church, to the religious church. Because I know that you know, the background that I came from was very Pharisaical. I mean, I don't think it could get much more Pharisaical in the way that it was presented. I'm not saying that everybody in that church is a Pharisee, but to some degree you had to be or you couldn't exist there. But when I left that organization and resigned the church that I was pastoring, that's what the Lord told me, and I've talked about this before, so I'm not going into all of that other than to say that the Lord told me at that point, if I didn't go back and open this Bible and read it like I had never read it before, not meaning read it a whole lot more than you ever did, but just read it with an open mind, not with, from a doctrinal, you know, denominational kind of viewpoint, but just read it and allow the Lord to speak to you. And he told me if I didn't do that, I was never going any further than where I was. I mean, I would never gain any knowledge of God or get any deeper in my relationship with the Lord. So hopefully I've done that. I'm not saying I've arrived by any means, but I do see things differently than I used to, and I do try to take the entire Bible into the context of which I'm teaching. So it's not just, I don't just have an agenda that I'm trying to promote, and so I get scriptures together to try to force them into that mindset. And I say that because, you know, we talk about existentialism, which is basically, and just the simple definition is just existence precedes essence. And we always thought of that in the past, I guess, or at least that's the way it was taught in college and other formats, is that this is an atheistic viewpoint, basically. But it's not true. This existentialism actually exists in the church. And in some ways, it dominates the church. And I'm not saying this just to be profound or to be, you know, controversial. I'm just saying that I see it. You know, I mean, I experience it myself. And so what I'm saying is we don't find meaning, we create meaning. It's like the small groups. Sally and I, you know, we taught home Bible studies multitudes of times. When we were in Texas, we were in charge of a small group. And so I know how these things go, and you know home Bible studies and all that's all good. I'm not against any of it. I'm just saying I know what can happen there. You end up a lot of them. They have these subjective impressions about Scripture. In other words, what it means to me without the context that the Bible's trying to give you. In other words, you go there looking for that, and then you're going to find it somewhere, somehow. You're going to make it fit, right? Instead of just trying to look at the Bible and say, what's the entire Bible saying about this thing? Okay, so with that in mind, let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18. This is not, I'm not picking on people, okay? I know it kind of got weird Wednesday night. I didn't mean to be. I just am. But sometimes, you know, you just get down a path and you realize, okay, that's where the Holy Ghost is. And I don't really necessarily know why, so I'm just trying to stay in step with him, and it sometimes can get awkward because he knows and I don't. So you just try to, you know, be faithful to what he's trying to tell you. So it wasn't that I was being critical or anything, it's just it was awkward. It was awkward for me, so I felt it must have been awkward for everybody else, praise the Lord. But that's just because I think everything's about me. And we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, I want you to look at this. Just let this kind of bounce around in your head for a second or two when we go to the next scripture. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. In one sense, that's this right here. This is the Word of God, okay? And we're changed into that same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Okay? Now, Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So you see the really great moments in life, the really powerful moments, the moments of joy and moments of self-satisfaction are not about me. They're not about you. they're really about self-forgetfulness.
Yes. Yes.
And when you look at these two scriptures, they don't contradict each other in any way other than just the way that I'm looking at them right now, okay? We're supposed to do this. We're supposed to look in here and we're supposed to be transformed by this word.
Yes.
Amen? But kind of the way it's gotten, this existentialism that I'm talking about, without becoming, you know, getting all involved in philosophy and all that, but I'm just saying, you're standing before the glory of God and you're contemplating your own greatness. Let me tell you, that's pathological. The church is filled with this kind of stuff. And that's why I'm not against, you know, I want us to be led by the Spirit. I want us to operate in the Spirit. But I want it to be about Jesus. Because what I've seen over the years is it becomes about people. It becomes about somebody with a word or with a knowledge or with this or that. And I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. We encourage it all the time. That's what we do here is try to get everybody. And part of the reason for getting everybody involved is so that no somebody can then be in charge. I don't want to be. And sometimes I think people think, well, you know, he's kind of an adult here. I mean, why doesn't he just take over? Because I don't want this. I don't want the power. I don't want the pressure. I don't need it, and I'm not supposed to have it.
Come on.
Take a look, and power corrupts, and absolute power absolutely corrupts, and I'm human like everybody else, and I don't need the aggravation.
Right.
You know, I want God to do it.
Yes.
But, you know, in doing that, you can sometimes put yourself in a position where you can get knifed in the back. Because there are people looking for power all the time.
Yeah,
amen. So that's all I'm talking about. I'm just saying, this is not about us outside of Christ. We are made for magnificent joy. We're made for something fantastic from outside of ourselves. And I'm not trying to contradict myself, but that's what Paul's saying in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. When we've been united with Christ, it's not about us becoming something great.
No.
It's about Christ being revealed.
Yes.
And our consciousness of that.
Yes.
So as believers, we are because of the essence of Christ, not the opposite.
Yes.
I mean, Christ doesn't exist just because I believe it.
Right.
He believes it, or he exists whether I believe it or not.
Right. Sure.
Amen? So we talked before about certain aspects of salvation, about being made one with God, about the incarnation, about the cross, about death, about resurrection and ascension and the Holy Spirit and all of these things. The most central act of salvation isn't any one of those. Again, salvation isn't something, it's somebody, it's someone. Amen? So, all of those are the central truth of salvation. To share in salvation, that's Christ, then we have to be joined or made one, right?
Yes.
So what I'm saying is, when we were sitting out on the deck yesterday, and I've done a few little odds and ends around the yard, and we were sitting out there and enjoying the nice warm weather, and I just thought about the warmth of the sun. You know, the laughter of children. Grandchildren, maybe your own children, just children itself, it's just, it's cool, right? The smell of flowers, it's getting that time of the year where it won't be long and things will start blooming if it doesn't all freeze off. My wife is paranoid about that, but pray for her and the flowers. The very ground under my feet, you know, the sound of my wife's voice. The sheer being of things is what I'm talking about.
Yes.
That if I didn't have them, I'd pay $1 million to get them.
Sure. Yes.
Having them and ignore them.
Yeah.
That's also Christ in you. Something we'd give everything for. It's the pearl of great price. It's the, you know, you can go through all of parables, but it's the thing. And how great that is. And yet ignore it. Be oblivious to it. So much of our time, so much of the time that we exist. I'm not talking about we just come to a point where all of a sudden that's true. I'm saying we know it's true, but there are so much of our life, so big a portions of our day and our so on, that's we're not aware.
Right.
We're ignoring it. We're ignorant of it. So I'm going to say some things this morning. And it may sound like I'm trying to push an agenda. It's not that. It's not like I'm trying to force something. It's like I'm just trying to say, this is what's on me, okay? I happen to pastor the church, so I have to assume this is what God's trying to get me to get across to you. And because I'm not perfect at it, because I think one way and I don't necessarily communicate the same way, that I just keep beating. Sometimes I think it's a dead horse. I know you're not dead. I just keep beating because I'm assuming pretty soon you're going to, woo, you know, praise the Lord, I got it, hallelujah.
Yeah.
And maybe you already got it, but it hasn't left me, so I'm still at it, praise the Lord. So let's look at this, John chapter 3, verse 6. I got three one-verse scriptures here I want to read as we get into this. So it's beginning with John chapter 3 and verse 6. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. All right, John chapter 6, verse 63. It's the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. All right. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So according to the Bible, if you are born from above, if you're born of incorruptible seed, the incorruptible word of God, you've been united to the risen Savior, right? You've been united to the risen Christ, joined to his body and individual members of it, all right? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 14 talks about this. 1 Corinthians 12, 12 through 14. We're all one body, for as the body is one, hath many members. All the members of that one body, being many, are one body. So also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. Verse 27, Mike. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. So instead of some kind of ethereal or spiritual body, Paul describes the union between Christ and us as a kind of physical union, a physical union of individual bodies with the individual body of Christ. So the question is, what type of union do we share with Christ's physical body? In other words, do we replace Christ's literal body here on earth? Or conversely, are we so absorbed into Christ, into his own physical body, that we lose our distinctiveness? So look at Matthew chapter 11 and verse 29. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. Take my yoke. Yoke up with me, okay? Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So we are distinct persons, and yet we are living in the same reality with the same goals, the same purpose, the same love, the same yoke as Jesus. John chapter 14, Mike, verses 9 through 14. John 14, verses 9 through 14. So Jesus saith unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, I said what I said in the beginning, talking about existentialism, not just to, you know, throw about a big word here, but to show you that when you really begin to hear God, when God begins to speak to you, all of a sudden all scriptures start to make sense. Scriptures that taking by themselves may not really make a lot of sense, but all of a sudden now you can go throughout the entire Bible and begin to connect. They start making sense because it's no longer about me trying to promote a particular thought, but it's the thought's just there and it reveals itself. You just start seeing it. Ever, we call it revelation, but it's the same thing as saying, it's not me trying to make it say something now, it's saying something that I can't avoid. I can't ignore it and make it, you know, something else, right? So the Word is made flesh. Jesus embodied the nature of God in order for the world to see God. God is invisible, no man is seen. So somehow, Jesus is going to show God. So he's the Word, right? And so the Word shows up in order for the world to see God. And then, you know, go forward a couple thousand years or more, and we then are to make him visible to the world. Right? All right, so, but you see what I mean? There's nothing pathological about Jesus because he's saying, it's not about me, it's the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He said, I'm not trying to promote an agenda here. I don't have. I'm just here to represent the Father. I'm here so that you can see the Father. It's not me doing this. It's God that's doing it. I'm just here so that you can see what God does. Amen? And so that's the point I was trying to make before. But Luke chapter 1 and verse 28. And the angel came unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Amen. Now, let's look at verses 30 through 33, Mike. I'm not skipping to omit anything. I'm just skipping for the sake of time and some things. All right. So the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. Praise the Lord. He shall be great, shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Now, Mary didn't get this. She didn't understand how this is going to happen, right? So then we have Luke chapter 1, 34 and 35. Can we just continue on? And then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I don't know a man? I've never had a relationship, you know, physical, sexual relationship with a guy, so how's this going to happen, right? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost will come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Here's Mary's response, Luke 1:38. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed her. So she confesses and agrees with the word. Yes. Right?
Yep.
Now Mary rejoiced, the scripture says. And she received God's word. And actually, she conceived God's word that was sent by an angel. All right, look at John now, chapter 16 and verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19 through 21. 2 Peter 1, 19 through 21. I know it's a lot of scripture, but I'm just trying to not be a hypocrite. Praise the Lord. Tell you one thing and then do something else.
Amen.
So, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Knowing this first, no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but the holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Amen. So the Holy Spirit is the author of God's word. I mean, a lot of people wrote it, but he's the one that inspired him. He's the one that gave them what to write. Amen. So the Holy Spirit would overshadow her, the Scripture says, right? Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth, mm-hmm. the Spirit of the Word.
Yes.
Keep that in mind. Praise the Lord. So the Word of God came to Mary. You're going to conceive and bear a child. And she said, be it unto me according to your word.
Yes. Right.
Now Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they're filled with life.
Yes.
They're spirit and they're life.
Yes.
We are born again of the Spirit by the Spirit of truth. Yes. So you can't look at this immaculate conception as some biological thing, because it won't ever make any kind of sense that way. It's not supposed to. God didn't intend it to. But that's what happens as humans. We figure, man, there's got to be some fallacy, and God's invisible. How to, you know, anyway. So I'll let your own minds race with it, but praise the Lord. Romans chapter 10, verses 8 through 10. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. All right, 1 Peter 1:23. Remember he said, the incorruptible. We're not born again by human means.
Right.
We were born initially that way as humans. But when we get born again as children of God, as spirit, alive beings,
yes.
now we're born not of corruptible seed, not of sperm and egg, but now of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. He wrote it that way because he wants us to understand it that way.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, the Word of God is a living, incorruptible seed that permanently dwells and abides.
Yes.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. See, I'm saying this is more than you go to the altar and confess your sins. I'm not saying that isn't a good thing. I'm not saying that we shouldn't pray the prayer of faith. That's just a means by which this can, what God's already wanted to do, accomplish, can be made any kind of sense to us. So in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God.
Yes.
It wasn't just an associate of God. It wasn't just somebody hanging out with God. The Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Yes.
Amen. So the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Amen. The Word was made flesh. All right. John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh. Right? The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The same Word that was with God, that was God in the beginning, was made flesh.
Yes.
Amen? Just think of it. The seed of the woman in Genesis 3:15 was the seed of the incorruptible Word of God. God said to the woman, this is what's going to happen. That word, that seed that God sowed, was born. The incorruptible seed, he wasn't talking about every human being that's going to be born is born of the incorruptible. He said the one that's going to defeat the enemy, the one that's going to put everything back on the track that it was on originally before Satan got in here and screwed everything up, he said the seed of the woman will crush his head. The incorruptible seed I'm talking about, this seed of the woman, the incorruptible Word of God, that's the same incorruptible seed that's talked about in 1:23. That we receive, we're born again. Okay, praise the Lord. So Mary conceived the Word in her spirit. And it manifested itself in her physical body.
Right.
That's healing.
Yes.
That's deliverance.
Yes.
That's prosperity. That's everything that we talk about. She received the Word by faith in her spirit. And it manifests in our body. So this is not a one thing we're kind of force this thing down a narrow little tube. This is the everything that God's talking about in the Bible, and we've made it about everything else. That's why I keep talking about this being one with Jesus. Of course, the problem is we're thinking, you know, we're one, we're really close, we're hanging together, it's way beyond all of that, and that's what I'm saying this morning is that maybe hopefully. Now, I don't mean to dumb it down, but to make it just simple, just as simple as God made it in the first place.
Yes.
That religion has spent 2,000 years screwing this up and trying to make, and we've inherited all this lies and confusion, us Gentiles, amen, because we never understood the Scripture in the first place. So when it comes along, then we try to make it fit one of our 30,000 denominational ideas and viewpoints instead of trying to figure out what is God really trying to say to his body.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, John 1:14. The Spirit became flesh and dwelt among us. You don't have, okay, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. The glory is the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So one translation says the Word took upon itself flesh. The Word was with God in heaven in the beginning. It became flesh. And when the Word became flesh, he was called Jesus. And what did Jesus come to do? To destroy the works of the devil.
Yes.
The Word destroys the works of the devil.
Yes.
Not a man, but a man filled with the Word.
Yes.
He was fully man, but he was a man fully filled with the Word of God. He was the Word of God in flesh. The essence of this guy is what we're interested in. Amen.
Yeah.
Not the humanity of him, which is all good because we can relate to the humanity of it. But again, it's trying to get existence ahead of essence.
Yeah.
It's this whole idea that we look at this and then we try to make everything fit into that. It doesn't work that way. You have to see the essence. This is not existentialism. This is Christianity. And just because it pervades our society and our cultures and our world doesn't mean we have to suck up to it and buy into it and believe it.
Right.
It's a lie of the devil. Yes. It's not just atheism, although atheism, loves it and expounds it all the time. It's a part of all of the way that we think because you send a kid, I just read something the other day. You send a kid to school, okay? At 3 years old, it's a proven fact studies all over that a three-year-old is creative as all get out.
Yes.
To borrow a phrase of my father, praise the Lord. Not my heavenly father, my dad. Amen. Little kids are creative. They have dreams. They can imagine anything and it can be real. They can expect to do anything. when I get big, I'm going to be, you know, an astronaut. Yeah. Oh, okay, honey, well, that's very good. But we know that you're a little girl and you're three and you live in America and chances are you'll be a housewife. Yeah. Not that there's anything wrong with being a housewife, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And now, okay, then they go to school.
Yeah.
How many of you, when you went to school, were bored to tears? Mm-hmm. Doesn't mean you're an idiot. It might have meant that you were smarter than most of the people in the class and you had a way of thinking that didn't fit the regimen that they're trying to force you into once you get to school. Because they got a thing they're trying to get you to do, and that is pass tests. They don't care what you know. They just want you to be able to pass the test. So you study and you remember and you memorize so that you can get a grade and go to the next grade. And without ever really learning anything. But the point I'm making is, that three-year-old, by the time they're 6 years old, their creativity has fallen off almost by 60%. Why? Because there's no call for them to be creative anymore. The demand now is to be rote, to just get in line and take the repetitious stuff that comes at you. And then we wonder why is it we have problems with creativity, with kids thinking outside the box, so to speak, or thinking anyway. That's what's so damnable about taking Christianity out of the schools. Part of the rote now is there is no God, or if there is a God, he's really just kind of out here flying around somewhere like a deist that just rolled the dice and said, there it is, good luck.
Yeah.
See you when you die.
Yeah.
Amen. So that was just a rant. I don't know if that had anything to do with this, but praise the Lord. Where was I anyway? Praise God. So, when we talk about Jesus, the problem is so much of the time we disassociate him from the Word and from what John 1:1 says about him, that in the beginning he was the Word, he was with God, he was God, the Word was, amen? And so we have this tendency to disassociate him from that and what it says about him. Jesus, in the Word form, was the creator of everything. Nothing happened until words went forth, right? So when Jesus is God, and when he and God are one, and he's there, the Word create everything.
Yes.
Nothing exists until the Word comes, right?
Right?
All right, look at John chapter 14 now, verses 12 and 13. John 14, 12 and 13. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. Whatsoever you ask in my name, that will I do. What's his name? It's Jesus, but what was his name before he was flesh? The Word. Whatever you ask. See, we're running around Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I'm not trying to be disrespectful here to say that's not, but that really isn't the point. You have received his name.
Yes.
So when you speak the Word,
yes,
you're speaking, not only are you speaking his name, but you're speaking in the authority of his name because you've been born again of the Father. Now you have that inheritance. You're a joint heir and so on and so forth. So anyway, I do shall you do also, and greater works than these shall you do, because I go to my Father. What? So I can send back the Spirit of the Word, or the Spirit of truth, that you can be filled with the Word, with God.
Yes.
Amen. And whatsoever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son, the same way the Father was glorified in the first place, by the Word being manifest.
Yes.
The essence of God having existence.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, whatsoever you ask in my name, that will I do. Amen. So 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. 2 Peter 1 verse 3. According as his divine power, well, keep this all in context here. So according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. The divine power is the Word of God. The divine power is what created everything. Right? So it's, you can say, according as his Word has given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Divine power hath given. All right, Romans 1, verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Amen. I'm not ashamed of the good news of the word. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek.
Yes. Yes.
All right, 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4. I know this is a lot to digest, but come on, you're bright. You have the Holy Spirit. You get it. I mean, you can get it. Just go home and meditate. Amen. Just look at the word of God. Look at the power.
Yes.
Amen. So whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these, what are these promises? They're the word of God, are they not?
Yes, they are.
So here you have the power, these precious promises, exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you can become partakers of his nature. What is his nature? His essence. What is his essence? The word.
Yes. Yes.
Having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. Praise the Lord. So we're united to Jesus, the Word, the power, and we're born again from above by the incorruptible Word. The Creator of everything has created you a new creature in Christ. A creature, a Word creature. Amen. A God person. Praise the Lord. Born from above, the Scripture says. All right, let's go to Hebrews 11, 1. By faith, right? Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
Right.
Substance. What is substance? Substance is the raw material or the thing that causes manifestation.
Right?
Right?
Yeah.
All right? Back to Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 3. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the raw material that's going to manifest. God, who at sundry times and divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself, purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. All right, leave it up there. Go back to verse 2 if you can, Mike. Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, by whom also he made the world. So the Word made everything.
Yes.
He framed it all. He made it all, right?
Yes.
All right, verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. Now, God's glory, God's express image, right? He is the exact expression of God's person. Is that not what it says? The Word of God, or Jesus, was the exact expression of God's substance. The Word of God is God's essence. It's his substance.
Yes.
Amen. You can look forever and God's invisible. Why? Because you can't see my words, but they create images. They make things come alive, right? Like everybody's words do. That's what separates us from the animals.
Yes.
We are made a little higher, lower than angels, but higher than every other created being here, because we are filled with words.
Yes.
More importantly, when we are born again, we are filled with the Word.
Yes.
The power. That's why we have power to do things, and we're still trying to do stuff in the flesh and trying to get the right guy or the right woman to pray the right prayer. When you are filled with all the power that there is that created the universe in the first place, and it is the Word of God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. The exact expression of God's substance, the Word of his power. All right. Look at John chapter 14. In verse 9. Jesus saith unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Now, the word person in Hebrews 1:3, being the express image of his person, is the way it's written in Hebrews 1:3. The word, and I'm not a Greek scholar, so I'll say it, but it'll be messed up. Hypostasis. Now, how that is actually where the syllables are pronounced or not pronounced, I don't know, but that's the way it's spelled. Hypostasis, H-U-P-O-S-T-A-S-I-S. That is the very same word translated substance in Hebrews 11:1. Or, excuse me, yeah, 11:1. So the word person in Hebrews 1 and 3, the express image of his person, that word is the same word that is translated substance in Hebrews 11:1. So what am I saying? I'm saying that you can say faith is the person of things hoped for.
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
We're thinking it's a thing. Again, it's not. This is salvation. Salvation isn't a bunch of different things that come together. Salvation is a person.
Yes.
And that person is the Word of God.
Yes.
And so that's what he's telling us in Hebrews 11:1. You can say faith is the person of everything that I'm hoping for.
Yes.
In that person is everything that I have hope of.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So Jesus is the Word in person form. Or you could say he's the Word personified.
Yes.
So you could read Hebrews 1 and 3 then. Who being the brightness of his glory and the expressed image of God's substance.
Yes.
Because of the same word, right? He is the brightness of God's glory, the express image of God's substance. What God was,
yes.
The Word.
Yes.
His Word was. Whatever God was, His Word is.
Yes. Yes.
People think we'll go far enough into space at some point we'll actually see God. I don't know. Man, that's like saying I understand astrology. I just don't understand how they get the names for them, the stars. Okay, never mind. Praise the Lord. But I'm just saying, you know, I'm just saying that this is all of God you're going to see outside of the body of flesh, now the glorified body, that is filled with that Word.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Come on.
Look full in His wonderful face.
Yes.
Right there. Anytime you want. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
God's substance is the Word.
Yes.
Or He wouldn't have robed it in flesh to be the exact representation.
Yes.
All right, John 1:1 again. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God.
Yes.
It's... Man, I mean, you've got to be religious to screw that up.
Yeah.
You have to work at that to make that something other than what it is.
Right.
We're born again by Jesus. By Jesus. Not corruptible seed, but the incorruptible Word of God.
Yes.
The Word is life. And it's spirit.
Yes.
It's alive.
Yes.
It's abiding.
Yes.
It's eternal. And every time we say it, we release a manifestation of God when we understand what's being released.
Yes.
It's not just idle words. It's not just words on a page. This is God being exploded into our lives, into the lives of the people that we encounter, and it will change everything.
Yes.
Talk to somebody that's been healed. Talk to somebody that didn't do it through a healing school, but just got the Word of God or got a word from God and said, by His stripes we were healed and we're standing on the Word of God. Hallelujah. Until we see the substance manifest, because it has to come to pass. We are united to the Word of God. Our union isn't something that we pursue. It's somebody that has chased us down. We heard the scripture this morning. Amen. That we are, that we're pursuing, you know, we're pressing toward the mark to apprehend that which has already apprehended us. In other words, all we're trying to do is wake up to what has got us. Praise the Lord. So, Matthew chapter 4 and verse 4. I don't know, you hear it from preachers all the time, but this will change your life. It has already changed your life if you just wake up to it and start living this life. So he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Why? Because out of every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, I can get my bread every day. I can get my clothes every day. I can get my automobile. I can get my house payment made. I can get healed. I can get delivered. I can get everything that I have need of by the power of God, which is his word, amen, in human flesh again. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 and 5. 2 Corinthians 13, verses 4 and 5. For though he was crucified through weakness, yet he lived by the power of God. How did he live by the power of God? By the word. I only say what I hear my Father say, right? For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you. Amen. Examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be reprobates? The word of his power. By the word of God, we're born again. Yes. That word is in us. Yes. It's alive. It abides in us. If you abide in the word and the word abides in you, you can't help but bear fruit. Right. See, we're making it about a somebody or something rather than the somebody, which is the word. Yes. We're thinking inanimate here. We're thinking existence ahead of essence. And it's no wonder we don't get anything. It's no wonder it's like a continuous crapshoot our whole life. You get up, you roll the dice today, maybe it comes up seven, maybe it comes up snake eyes, maybe you get boxcars and you never hit them again. If you're always throwing money in the pot and getting very little back. Sorry for the analogy there, but praise the Lord. I lost money at craps one time when I was in the Marine Corps and never played again. Praise the Lord. My money was more important than winning, praise God. But that word is in John 17. I want to read verses 14 through 22, Mike. John 17, verses 14 through 22. We're just about done here, guys. So. In fact, I think this is the last scripture. John 17, verses 14 through 22. I've given them thy word. The world hath hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. In another place he says, I sanctify myself that they might be sanctified. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. For their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth, through the word. I'm sanctifying myself. The word is sanctified so that they, having the word, will be sanctified as a result, right? Yes. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Yes. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, the word, and I in you. They were one in the beginning. The word was with God. The word was God. That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Yes. Praise God. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, yes, that they may be one, even as we are one. Yes. So how does God get manifest? When we speak the word, when we release the word in faith for manifestation, for healings, for deliverance, for salvation, because they got to receive the word and speak the word. They've got to receive it in their heart and then confess it with their mouth. Yes. You shall be saved.
Yes.
You just got Jesus in you.
Yes.
Amen. You just confessed that you got Jesus in you, and now you've been saved by the Word of God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We're born of the Word. We live by the Word. We're healed by the Word. We're prospered by the Word. We're set free by the Word. Everything happens by the Word of God. See, the realness of this, back to where I started, the sheer being of it, that if it were not, we'd pay $1 billion to have it. And yet we ignore. Religion ignores and talks about everything else. Having it, ignore. So I'm saying this morning, wake up today. Wake up every day, all day, to the realness of Christ in you. To know this word and then focus on us, on our problems, on our issues, on our stuff. To know this word and then to make the focus on us is pathological, I'm telling you. If you did it in any other way, a psychiatrist would say, I'll get you on Prozac and, you know, you need to reevaluate some stuff here. Your priorities are all screwed up. There's a reality outside of ourselves.
Yes.
And it's in us.
Yes.
I love that. There's this a reality outside of us. And it's in us. There is an existence, but it means nothing without the essence. Christ, the hope of glory. The hope of God's substance. Revealed in us, the essence of God being revealed in human form.
Yes.
That's what God has called you to. That's what God saved you for. That's the truth. It's the word of truth.
Amen.
And it will change your life.
Yes.
And just as importantly, it'll change the lives of everybody that you came into contact with. If you believe it the way Jesus believed it, it'll do exactly the same thing for you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Think about it this way. And they'll quit. You were in Christ. You were in the Word before the foundation of the world. You were there in the Word when God created everything. Praise the Lord.
Yes, we are.
Something that you brought up today that absolutely cleared up something Jane and I were talking about this week. And it happened on the road to Emmaus. It happened at the site of the lake. Fish cooking and they Peter threw on a coat, dove in and swam to him. And the thing of it is, they didn't recognize this image. Now, but what cleared it up today, and I can't believe I've never seen it, but it was the substance. His substance was not altered.
Exactly.
They recognized his spirit. His, you know, but they something at me. You know, I looked at it. Gee, they didn't recognize him. So they dared not ask who he was because they knew who he was.
Right.
Yes.
If you think about it, in heaven, the scripture says, we will be known as we are known.
Yes.
Now, does that mean we're all got the same physical look that we have here? I don't know how that can be when some people didn't know me until I was 55 or 60.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was a much better looking guy than I was 25. I'm just saying,
good.
They know us by our substance.
Yes.
Because that's something we all have. That's all the family tree. The DNA is the same for all of us. We recognize that in each one
of us.
Amen.
Right.
God bless you, Amen. Give a round of applause. Amen. We're dismissed in Jesus' name. Now, just go and live the word, hallelujah, and see if it doesn't change things in your life. Praise God.